Now, in this session, we will discuss about activity life cycle states. First, let me write important activity life cycle methods. Now, this is just a theoretical concept. The time between on resume method and on pause method is considered as foreground state or resumed state, because on pause method will be called as the first indication that user is moving away from your activity. That means some other activity is coming to foreground state. So the time between on resume and on pause is considered as foreground state or resumed state. Similarly, when the control is in between on start method and on stop method, that is the time between on start method and on stop method is considered as visible time or visible state, because only after calling on start method your screen will be visible to user. Similarly, if you remember on stop method will be called once your screen will become completely invisible to user. That means when the control is in between on start method and on stop method, your screen is visible to user. So that's why it is considered as visible state or visible time. Similarly, the time between on create method and on destroy method is considered as entire lifetime state, because on create method will be called only after creating memory for your activity object. That means your activity will be created in the memory before on create method. Similarly, on destroy method just before removing your activity from memory. So that means your activity will be in the memory in between on create method and on destroy method. After on destroy method, your activity will be removed from memory. So these three are considered as activity states. Now, we know that activity contains many important life cycle methods. Though there are 8 life cycle methods, it is not mandatory that programmer should use all methods, or programmer need not implement all methods. But still, I will cover what to do in each life cycle method. First method is onCreate method. Mostly in onCreate method, we will load our activity XML by using a setContentView method. Similarly, in onCreate method, we will initialize all our variables by using a findViewById method. For example, button b equal to findViewById r.id.button1, so on so. Mostly in onCreate method, we will initialize all variables and we will load our screen design XML. Similarly, in onStart method, it is not very important method, but you can use this method to register any important broadcast announcements that affects your activity user interface. As of now, don't worry too much about this method, because we don't know what is this broadcast announcements. If it is possible, keep this point in the mind. Otherwise, as of now, you can omit this method. Next method is onResume method. If your application has any CPU intensive works which consumes lot of CPU time and lot of battery power, for example, starting animations or starting a camera or starting flashlight or loading heavy images, so on so, you can start all these CPU intensive works in onResume method. Again, remember, this is just industry standards and guidelines, but still you can do everything in onCreate method also, but it is better to follow some standards. Coming to onPause method, out of all these lifecycle methods, onCreate method and onPause method is very important. The purpose of onPause method is, in onPause method we will save all important unsaved data, especially persistent data. Persistent data means permanent data. Similarly, whatever you have done in onResume method, you have to stop all those things in onPause method, because onPause method is opposite method for onResume. We know that in onResume method, if programmer has started any CPU intensive works depending on the program requirement, then programmer should stop or pause all those CPU intensive works in onPause method. For example, if you have started flashlight or if you have started animation in onResume method, then pause those animations and stop flashlight in onPause method. Because onPause method is an indication that user is moving away from your activity. So when user is moving away from your activity, no point in playing animations, which will consume unnecessary CPU time and battery power. Coming to onStop method, whatever you have done in onStart method, reverse all those things in onStop method, because onStop method is opposite method for onStart method. In onStart method, we are registering some broadcast announcements, so we have to unregister all broadcast receivers that affects your activity user interface in this method. As I told you already, as of now, don't worry about onStart method and onStop method. We will discuss later these two methods while discussing about broadcast receivers. So as of now, you can skip this method also. Coming to onDestroy method, in onCreate method, whatever you are doing, you just reverse those things in onDestroy method. For example, in onCreate method, if you are opening any important system resources like files or databases, clean all important system resources in onDestroy method. All the cleaning process can be done here in this method optionally. Optionally means if you have opened any important system resources in onCreate method, close all those resources in onDestroy method. Coming to onRestart, we know that onRestart method will be called when user is navigating back to your activity after closing newly displayed screen on top of your current screen. So if your old activity needs to be refreshed before user navigates back to your screen, that refreshing task can be done in onRestart method. For example, user has opened your activity and in your activity, user is downloading some movie. Let us say, on top of your activity, suddenly a new activity came. Now, when user presses back button on the new activity, still your background activity will be busy in downloading movie, so you should refresh progress bar. So probably when you come back to your old activity might have downloaded some content. So based on the downloaded content, you may need to refresh UI by showing a progress bar. So such kind of UI refreshments can be done in onRestart method when user is navigating back to your old activity. Anyway, I will show you a lot of examples covering all these lifecycle methods in our ongoing sessions. Now coming to onSave instance state method. In this method, programmer should save all important activity states or transient data, which means temporary data, in this method. In onRestore instance state method, programmer should restore previously saved activity states in this method. In onSave, programmer will save states. In onRestore, programmer will restore activity states. There is a chance that you may get confused in between onPause method and onSave method. Observe carefully. In onPause method also, I am saying save all important unsaved data, that is persistent data. Even in onSave also, I am saying save all important activity states or transient data. Now, I will explain what is the difference between this persistent data and a transient data, so that you will get clarity what to do in onPause method and what to do in onSave method. Remember, this can be an important interview question also, especially onCreate method, onPause method and onSave method. All these three methods are important for a programmer. Now, let me discuss about difference between transient data and persistent data, or in other terms, what programmer should do in onPause method and onSave method. From now onwards, I will be calling onSave instance state method as onSave method for my explanation convenience. Now, when user is interacting with our application, there is a possibility that user interaction may result in changing our activity states or changing important application data or change in important application data. Let me explain more clearly by taking two examples. First example is, let us say user is playing a balloon game, and imagine that here our assumption is, whenever user reopens our balloon game application, score will be reset to 0. That means our score value will start from 0. Now let us say user is playing our game, and so far user has blasted 100 balloons, and let us say current score is 100. Now in order to keep track of score, let us say programmer is internally using an integer variable called as count. So let us say current count value is 100. Now in this example, there are two scenarios. First scenario is, when user presses back button to close the application, do we have to save this count variable value or not? Of course, obviously, we don't have to save count variable value, because user clearly knows that when user exits the application and reopens the application, obviously score will start from 0. So we don't have to save count value. So that means when user exits your application, we don't have to save count value. Let us say that is how we have designed our application. Second scenario is, when user is playing your game, let us say current score is 100, which is maintained by count value. Now while playing the game, let us say user has rotated the phone. Now tell me whether this score value and count value should be carried forward from portrait mode to landscape mode. Yes or no? So definitely yes. We know that when user rotates a phone, operating system will kill your activity and recreates your activity. So obviously, whatever the important activity states are there, or important temporary variables are there, we have to save and restore. So in the second scenario, when user rotates a phone, in this case, count value should be saved. But in the first scenario, when user presses back button, count value need not be saved. So here, the count variable value is considered as activity state or transient data or temporary data, which should be propagated properly in between portrait mode and landscape mode as long as user is playing the game. But once user closes the application, you don't have to save this game. Such kind of transient data or activity states should be saved in onSave instance state method. So don't save these variables in onPass, save it in onSave method. This is first example. Now let us say the same balloon game has multiple levels. Let us say the balloon game has from level 1 to level 100, and imagine that currently user is playing at level 10. And assume that after playing for 15 minutes, user has reached 15th level, and in the 15th level, current user score is 40, as user has blasted 40 balloons in level 15. First screen represents level 10, then level 11, 12, 13. I have missed 14th level. Let us say currently user is in level 15, and imagine that current score is 40. Now, in order to programmatically maintain, in order to track level number and score, let us say programmer is using two integer variables, one for level and one for score. For level, let us say programmer is using an integer variable called as level, and to keep track of score, let us say programmer is using an integer variable with name count. Let us say current count value is 40 and current level value is 15. Now, again in this example also, I will take one scenario, that is pressing back button. Now at this point of time, when current score is 40, let us say user is in the middle of level 15. Let us say user want to exit the application by pressing back button. Now tell me, out of these two values, that is level and count, which value should be saved permanently and which value need not be saved permanently? Obviously, level should be saved permanently, either in database or maybe in some file or maybe in some server by connecting to internet. Because when user reopens your application, obviously user will expect your application to show level 15, because user is leaving level 15 now. So that is how most of the games are written. Of course, user knows that since he is quitting level 15 in the middle, he knows that when he reopens the application at level 15, obviously score will start from 0. So that user is very well aware. So in this case, programmer need not save count value permanently, but level value should be saved permanently. So here level is considered as permanent data or persistent data, and the count value is considered as transient data or activity state. If user rotates a phone, in that case that count value should be propagated properly from portrait mode to landscape mode. So count value should be saved by using onSaveInstanceState method, whereas level value should be saved by using onPause method, probably in some database or in some files or in some secured file or maybe in some server. So I hope you understood the difference between transient data and permanent data. So this can be an important interview question also. Interviewer may ask you, in which life cycle will you save important data? That means most probably interviewer is asking about permanent data. So you should tell the important permanent data or persistent data should be saved in onPause method. Unless if interviewer specifically asks for how will you handle configuration changes and how will you save activity states in configuration changes. In that case, interviewer is asking about transient states or activity states. So for that you have to tell onSaveInstanceState method. So if programmer is doing any database transactions or file transactions or any payment transactions or server related transactions, all those transactions should be committed or saved in onPause method, but not in onSave method. Let me give the reason also why permanent data should be saved in onPause, why not in onSave. If you remember, onPause is the last guaranteed method that will be called definitely in every scenario, but onSave method may not be called in all scenarios. For example, if user presses back button, that is normal killing. In that case, onSave method will not be called because there is nothing to be saved. So I hope you understood how to save your data using activity lifecycle methods.